Good evening, everyone. Good afternoon. I'm Valerie Hopkins. I'm an international correspondent at the New York Times.
I'm Milan Šarić from Euronews Serbia. Over 500 participants, 80 speakers on 20 panels. In the next 3 days, we'll be dealing with broad fields of subjects such as war in Ukraine, regional security, EU enlargement in light of 20 years of Thessaloniki summit, capture state concept, and green transition.
But there's a lot to talk about, a lot of panelists, and you want to hear from them. But before we start, we'd like to introduce Igor Bandović, the director of the Belgrade Center for Security Policy, to officially open the conference. Please give him a round of applause.
Dear distinguished guests, excellencies, colleagues, and friends, welcome to the Belgrade Security Conference 2023. This year's conference title is Reconstructing the Global Order. This is the second edition of our conference, taking place as the conflict in Ukraine enters its second year, with no end in sight, and a new conflict in the Middle East triggered by brutal attacks on Israel that began last weekend threatens to turn relative peace in the Middle East into a regional conflict with unforeseeable consequences. Judging solely by these trends, the world is increasingly in a state of global disorder and less in a state of any defined order, except for the apparent illusion that such an order exists. Hence, the name of the conference this year. Speaking of illusions, the absence of a system and the illusion of order in the Balkans this year had terrifying consequences. It is incredible to even say this, but after so many years of negotiation attempts, talks, the dialogue, armed attacks in Kosovo last month are a horrific reminder of how fragile peace is in the Balkans and how close the war, death, and destruction are. How it is possible that in one reality we negotiate solutions, normalization of relations, and the European future of the Balkan countries, while simultaneously preparing for the armed conflict and gathering weapons for the war. The question arises, what is the reality and what is illusion? How many layers of reality are there? Is deception yet another reality? Or are we living in the multiverse where there are parallel truths? Perhaps these are the questions to deconstruct the global order or its non-existence. I hope we will find an answer to these questions in the panels that follow over the next 3 days. Unfortunately, we could not have predicted to include some topics in the panel, such as the current conflict in the Middle East, while for some subjects, like Kosovo, we made a conscious decision not to have them. After an attempt last year to invite representatives of Kosovo authorities to a panel in Belgrade, and after deliberate refusal of authorities in Belgrade to allow it, our assessment is that there are no conditions for discussing this topic in Belgrade, except for our appeal for the situation to de-escalate and for negotiating parties to return to the dialogue. We have also shared our concern about the political crisis in Serbia with the international public in this appeal, and together with colleagues from other civil society organizations, we will read it on the last day of the conference. The fact that the absence of a system that should curb violence among one another in society has tragic consequences is demonstrated by the veil of violence that has engulfed Serbia with its most horrifying consequences in May of this year in mass murders of young people in Belgrade and in municipality of Mladenovac. Answers to these questions about how these murders occurred, who is responsible for the failures that led them to failures to lead them to them, are not only a matter of responsibility we lay at the feet of these authorities, which they try to evade, but also a matter of responsibility we place on ourselves, knowing that we are responsible as a generation for a society in which the increase in violence has become characteristic of it. It seems that intolerance, conflicts, hatred and intolerance on a global level easily transition to regional, national, local, and micro levels, revealing that we only function in our small variation of the worlds we build fortresses around. There is no room for understanding, and the dialogue is just a propaganda trick. To reconcile the values we uphold and the views we have on the most critical issues of today, we invited with open hearts all those who we think can contribute to discussions on the conference themes in meetings and dialogues within and outside the conference itself. We are aware that our role as a think tank is primarily to influence government policies in areas we work on. We also understand that the lack of dialogue in society is a lack of ideas in it, and the lack of exchanging opinions is a poverty of the spirit. That's how we created our panels and invited our panel participants. In addition to traditional panels of our colleagues from civil society, who also create panels on topics they deal with every year, our desire was for relevant ministers from this government to join us, and we were really delighted that a few of them responded to invitation and confirmed their participation. Unfortunately, our excitement was short-lived. Just a few days before the conference, as if on a political command, the ministers began to cancel their participation. Our invitation for discussion will remain open to representatives of the authorities in Serbia, even after this conference, and we hope that, like at the events we organize throughout the region, within our BCSC leaders' meeting framework, they will be open to confronting opinions, criticism, and dialogue with opponents. On the other hand, we enrich our conference with people whose opinions we value, whose sharp minds we love, and who have joined us and helped to make the conference the best that Belgrade and the region can offer on security, foreign policy, regional and international relations topics. In that sense, the newly established BCSC Advisory Council will be the body with which we'll work on this in the future, and the members who have joined the council are Milica Delević, Director for Competitiveness, Governance and Political Affairs at the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, Vesela Černeva, Deputy Director of the European Council on Foreign Relations, and Ambassador Phil Ricker, Chair of the Wilson Center Global Euro Program. Please give them a round of applause. This year, we have paid particular attention to developing the BCSC Young Leaders concept because in the years ahead, we want to create the potential of young leaders from the Balkans who want to engage in the topics we address. They will be the ones carrying ideas for change, modernization, and the fight for better relations in the Balkans, in Europe, and in creating better societies to which they belong. Therefore, we will engage them, and we will not be selfish. We will hand over our role to them as soon as they desire it. Last but not the least, this year BCSC will award the Lighthouse Award for exceptional courage to an individual in the performance of their professional duties. If you stay at the reception after the panel tonight, you will have the opportunity to hear something about the award and why we are granting it. In the meantime, despite alarming news from the world, I wish you to enjoy good discussions in the next 3 days, to have many useful and intelligent conversations, and to make many contacts, and to make the best use of our conference, because it is yours, and you are part of it. Thank you.
Milovan Milovanović was a Serbian statesman, diplomat, university professor, and a theoretician of state and law. He was born 160 years ago in Belgrade on February 17, 1863. He was a member of parliament, ambassador of the Kingdom of Serbia to Rome from 1903 to 1907, minister of justice, minister of finance, minister of foreign affairs in several governments between 1908 and 1912, and the prime minister of the Kingdom of Serbia from 1911 until he died on June 18, 1912. Milovanović advocated for a balanced and measured Serbian foreign policy. Thanks most of all to Milovanović's diplomatic activity, Serbia made an alliance with Bulgaria that enabled the creation of the Balkan alliance against the Ottoman Empire. Although he died at the age of 49, still a young man in full political force, he was with no doubt one of the most important Serbian statesmen and diplomats. Several general principles can be clearly identified in Milovanović's foreign policy activity. They guided him in both presenting his views and his general behavior. These were leniency, flexibility, adaptability, and tolerance. He was known for his efforts to round his views and adapt them to the given situation. His diplomatic skills predestined him for numerous mediating roles. He loved middle-of-the-road solutions and compromises. His political activity was characterized by freedom of maneuvering and the absence of firm attachment to any particular principle. He was not burdened by prejudices or emotions. He distinguished himself as a mediator during the restoration of diplomatic relations with England in 1905 to 1906, after they were seriously damaged following the murder of King Alexander Obrenović during the May Revolution in 1903. A similar thing happened at the Hague Peace Conference in 1907, where Milovanović represented Serbia in a very convincing fashion. A top expert in international law and an agile orator, Milovanović drew the attention of the most prominent lawyers of that era. The friendships he managed to forge during his multilateral diplomatic activity proved to be very useful in his later political and diplomatic career, especially during the tensions with Austria-Hungary caused by the annexation of Bosnia and Herzegovina, 1908 to 1909. Milovanović approached foreign policy in a highly systematic way, which was a complete novelty in Serbian political culture. He defined clearly set goals, which were later to be elaborated and broken down into means to be used to achieve them. He presented the basics of such a rational approach for the first time in 1894, in a discussion entitled Our Foreign Policy. Believing that the main goal of Serbian politics at that time was the preservation of national independence, Milovanović defined the framework for its realization. His later writings only built on the principles that were presented in 1894. Milovanović strongly believed that there are no firm guarantees in relations between states and that everything is in a constant state of flux. Milovanović claimed that Serbia's foreign policy was not an independent and isolated phenomenon. A state cannot define its own goals without first identifying the goals of other interested parties, i.e., neighbors and great powers, as important participants in international relations. He believed that small Balkan states, such as Serbia, must first familiarize themselves with the interests of their powerful neighbors.
The focus of our foreign policy, Vienna and Rome. In relation to us, Austria-Hungary and Italy are two irons placed in the fire. Their interests will prevail, so one or the other will gain the upper hand, or they will have to reach a compromise.
Only then will Serbia be able to begin work to ensure that its interests coincide and overlap with the interests of great powers. According to Milovanović, Serbia had to build its policy into the program of the great powers, to present itself as indispensable. Milovanović's thesis was that small countries would never be able to impose their interests upon the great ones, and that their most important skill was to align their own interests with the politics of the powerful. Serbian interests were to be included and brought under European interests, which is how Serbia would make itself indispensable to the great powers. Milovanović claimed that, by resolving their interests in this way, the great European powers would also resolve the Serbian issue. He applied his theories to the example of Russia and Austria-Hungary as great powers. But he also paid much attention to Bulgaria, as the most important neighbor in the Balkans. Serbia was primarily to take care of its own interests.
We are not, nor do we want to be a tool of Russia or anyone else.
Milovanović rejected any sentimentality based on Orthodox or Slavic ties. Milovanović also very soberly approached the other powerful entity that had decision-making powers in the Balkans, Austria-Hungary.
Serbia is fully entering the political and economic system of Central Europe, together with the entire eastern half of the Balkan Peninsula and the port of Thessaloniki.
Looking at the current state of affairs, where Austria-Hungary pursued an extremely negative policy towards Serbia, Milovanović believed that this was another situation where Serbia had to behave highly rationally and responsibly. Considering the balance of powers, this dispute could not be resolved by military means. When all of Serbia called for war due to the annexation of Bosnia and Herzegovina by Austria-Hungary, Milovanović chose diplomacy and negotiations. Defending himself against the criticism of the MPs that his policy towards Austria-Hungary and other powers was much too lenient, Milovanović said the following at one of the sessions of the National Assembly.
Gentlemen, the difficulty of the position of the Minister of Foreign Affairs is that he is usually not able to use all the arguments that are available to him to defend himself or his actions. The Minister of Foreign Affairs must be considerate. The Minister of Foreign Affairs must be aware of the fact that his word does not represent just him, but the state as well. Therefore, he must be careful what he says. Gentlemen, I don't believe that any of you really think that I would not know how to belt out a patriotic tirade, that I would not know which heartstrings to pull, and when discussing foreign policy issues to be liked in the assembly and by the public. But gentlemen, speaking as the Minister of Foreign Affairs, I cannot and must not give in to those beautiful patriotic wishes. Instead, I must remain within the limits and follow the path of cold reason.
Austria-Hungary should not be given a reason for aggression. Instead, Serbia must fulfill its contractual obligations most scrupulously, be correct, be accommodating. In the event of a dispute, entrust everything to the great powers and the European public opinion. Patience played a very important role in Milovanović's understanding of foreign policy, as did winning the favor of the European public opinion. Serbia had to be tied to powerful friends. It is always important to stress the European importance of the Serbian issue, and very important to preserve allies. Reputation and sympathy for Serbia should be among the key assumptions of foreign policy. When it comes to patience, there is a well-known Milovanović's sentence from 1894. For great politics, it is important to be able to wait, and to be able to let go at an appropriate moment. Milovanović rejected fatalism. On the contrary, he believed that the state must devote itself to perseverance and show initiative and endurance in all areas. Milovanović was much more than a classic French student, of which there were quite a few in Serbia at the time. His affinity for the West, and foreign countries in general, was sincere and comprehensive. He was a highly cultured person who knew European museums and theaters. According to the French ambassador in Vienna, Milovanović was spoken of at the English court as the greatest European among the people of the Balkans. In his political life, he advocated for the democratization of Serbia based on the model of France. As a convinced democrat and critic of the authoritarian government, he once said,
"Like any free Serbian citizen, I'm allowed to think whatever I want about anyone, including His Royal Highness King Milan, His Royal Highness Alexander, and God himself."
With the future of the Balkan Peninsula always on his mind, Milovanović paid special attention to Serbia's neighbors. He saw the development of good neighborly relations in the Balkans as a priority and advocated for Balkan solidarity. He viewed the friction and hatred between Serbia and Bulgaria as pointless, passé, and a problem that could be resolved. He believed that it was possible to eliminate any misunderstanding, reconcile one's ambition, and create a common solid force. Milovanović brought reason and utilitarianism to Serbian politics. Interest, not feelings, is key in politics. On one occasion, near the end of his life, he said the following:
"I applied everything I knew and did everything I was able to do. I put all of my mind and heart into my work. The future will tell whether I was successful at it or not. And I'm not at all afraid of its judgment. Even in history of larger and stronger nations, there were moments, gentlemen, when they did not win, when it was not possible for them to win, and when they had to lose.
Your Excellencies, yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, exactly 30 years ago, my late father gave me this book written by Dimitrije Đorđević, a Serbian-American historian. And amongst the portraits of prominent historical figures from 19th and 20th century that I found in this book, I was particularly struck by the biography of Milovan Milovanović. He's probably amongst the most important and amongst the most forgotten Serbian statesmen. This is why we decided to dedicate the second Belgrade Security Conference to his memory. Celebration of the 160 years of his birth is a reminder that he is an example to be followed. So ever since my father gave me this book, I'm often asking myself, what would Milovan Milovanović do if he were to be here with us today? What would be his policy towards Russia's war of aggression in Ukraine? Would Serbia, with him at its helm, still be amongst the few in Europe refusing to introduce sanctions to Russia? What would he do in relation to the thorniest issues, Serbia's sovereignty and territorial dispute with Kosovo, European integration process? Would he, on a daily basis, instigate nationalistic rhetoric, hatred towards and fear from Serbia's neighbors? Milovanović loved naval metaphors. He often compared Serbia to a little ship on a stormy sea. Alone, it would sink, and sink in disgrace like it did in the 1990s. And in order to sail into a safe harbor, Milovanović believed it is essential for Serbia to tie itself to a larger, stronger ship. That ship today is certainly not Putin's Russia, but Europe, the United States, and our other Western allies. Membership in the European Union is that safe harbor for Serbia. Milovanović understood the importance of gaining sympathy with the European public opinion in order to assure that goal. With this logic, he would have introduced sanctions towards Russia a long time ago. He wouldn't allow the population of Serbia's most important ally, the European Union, to think that his country is Putin's Trojan horse in Europe. Milovanović wouldn't court domestic public opinion at the cost of gaining enemies abroad. He saw the development of good neighborly relations in the Balkans as a priority and advocated for Balkan solidarity. Milovanović's approach to foreign policy making was systemic. The precondition for defining a meaningful foreign policy is to understand the world. Today, this understanding is made much harder by domestic and foreign disinformation campaigns. The purpose of our conference is to break through this propaganda barrier. And this is what the Belgrade Security Conference is all about. Enjoy the next 2 days, stay with us, and tell to the world what we're discussing here today through your social media accounts. Thank you.
So now we'd like to get started with the first panel, Ukraine and the Allies, keeping the firm rock, unity and solidarity.
Some of the questions that are going to be dealt in the next hour, what is the future of Ukraine after the war with Russia? Will Kiev have to accept the secession of some of its part in return for EU membership? Or it will free its entire country before that? And what will the Ukraine's relations with NATO look like? Full membership or a strong alliance?
This is a topic very near and dear to me as I've just returned recently from a reporting trip in Ukraine, and I'm very eager to hear from the panelists who will speak about it. So I'd like to introduce and welcome to the stage Thomas Kleine Brockhoff from the German Marshall Fund of the United States, Marko Makovic, the Director and Deputy Managing Editor of the European External Action Service, Hannes Svoboda, the president of the International Institute for Peace and the Vienna Institute for International Economic Studies. And the panel will be moderated by Oana Popescu-Zamfir, founder and director of Global Focus Center. Thank you very much. Nice to see you. All right.
Thank you. Good to see you.
Is it here?
Maybe here. Hello and welcome, and thank you very much for starting the conference with this topic, because I think it's a very nice introduction to the dynamics that we're going to have in the coming days. And I think we have our other guest with us as well. Welcome, Marko.
Oh, hello.
Hi.
Let's get straight to business, so to speak, because we don't have a lot of time. And I would like to start the conversation with challenging its very title. And the question to you all is, do you feel that compared to a few months ago, we have the same rock-solid support for Ukraine? Has this been eroded by anything in particular? Has this been eroded by developments on the ground or by developments elsewhere in the US or Europe? Or has this consolidated? Thomas Kleine-Brockhoff, maybe you would like to start.
I think we've seen peak Ukraine. And peak Ukraine means that there may be a plateau of support, but there's no upward trajectory. And the reason for that is manifold. We've seen blinking, wavering in Europe. Shall I say Slovakia? Shall I say Poland? We're seeing the United States embroiled in a domestic debate where a unifying issue, one of two unifying issues of the domestic debate there, has become a dividing issue, and the Ukrainians are very concerned about that. I've been in Kiev last week, and what they say is every time that they become a political football in the United States doesn't end well for them. And we shouldn't forget the Israel situation. And that is not just the question of whether attention is being withdrawn from Ukraine, but it is also the question of diversion of interest, diversion of resources, and the question whether the West will see this as connected issues. Is this the second front? And will this rather... will this consolidate support, and then for both, or will it be seen as unrelated issues and therefore very little you can do about both, and some of the players, the Europeans, will focus more on Ukraine and the Americans more on Israel, as their domestic debate suggests to us.
Well, what do you think would be preferable? I mean, well, what's the best case scenario? That we see this as connected, or we act strategically, say, just... so to speak, or that we treat them differently?
Well, first of all, they have to be connected to be seen as connected. The question whether they are is an open one, whether it's an indirect connection, whether all of those who want to destroy the current order are working towards the same goal without or with little coordination, or whether you would have to say Hamas is the ally of Iran. Iran is the ally of Russia. Putin is the master of asymmetric escalation leading to symmetric advantage on the battlefield. I think that in the end doesn't matter. I think we have one solution on the table already, and that is what is going on in the United States right now with the proposal by the Biden administration to first go big and do a joint support bill in the U.S. Congress, and I think whether that has any chance of succeeding will be determinant for the question you've asked.
Thank you very much, and same question to you, Hannes Svoboda, but let me just add something to it, because we've heard that in Europe, Poland may have blinked, Slovakia may have blinked, Orban keeps blinking all the time. But does this matter if we have... a solid stance from countries like France or Germany or the Netherlands? Are there countries within the EU that have the power to steer this in one direction or the other, even when there is a little bit of opposition? Or do we really not have a united front and we're just putting together the pieces?
I think it matters. But let me start first by saying very bluntly, I think support is decreasing slowly, not too much. It can be reversed, but it is not only at the plateau, it is decreasing. It's decreasing, and what is very, very important to see are the interrelationship between public opinions in our countries, in smaller countries, in big countries, in the east side of the EU, in the US, but also in Ukraine. We had recently an event in Vienna 2 days ago where somebody told us about the opinion polls as far as it is possible to do it in Ukraine. And even there, at the moment or at the moments when Russia is successful, even people in Ukraine say, well, we have to talk to Russia, we have to start discussions, negotiations, whatever. So this is very important. And this, of course, reflects and comes back into our countries, with Slovakia especially, Hungary, maybe it was in Austria, maybe at the next election to European Parliament. These are all perhaps small steps as such, but they will influence. They will influence also the election and the population in the Netherlands. And then it goes to France, because France, yes, we have Macron, but we have also Le Pen on the door. And we don't know in Italy how the strong position of Meloni is transformed into reality in the next month. So yes, in addition to the US, which is the big question mark, we have smaller question marks, but in the sum, smaller question marks can be as important as the big question mark in the US. So I think it is very, very important. And my last addition to that, we cannot support Ukraine without support from our citizens. Now, not everybody can be convinced, but we do not enough to convince our citizens that the support for Ukraine is not only because of solidarity, the global order, to be against Russia, but it's their own security. It's their own security which is in danger. Our freedom, our not only freedom of expression, of media, our fake news fight and about fake news or not, and all these elements play into the same game. And here our politicians, and I'm a former politician, so I come back to this question again and again. We failed. We did not enough to convince with good arguments our citizens that your support for Ukraine is not only friendship and solidarity, but is in our citizens' basic interest.
Do you feel that this is likely to be a highly important and a highly divisive topic for next year's elections? And if that is the case, is it because it will be seen as an internal issue already, maybe because of inflation, maybe because of whatever other reasons? Because we all know European elections are very often about national politics. So is this likely to be part of it?
I think it is. Not on the first level and on the surface, but below. Because if you look to the parties who are, you know, fellow, not really supporting Ukraine, they are the same party who use, of course, high inflation, migration, a security issue, and then they use it in the reverse way. They say, if we go on with the fight in supporting in Ukraine, this is endangering our security. This is the argument of Mr. Orban. But we did not do enough to counter these arguments and say, no, it's the other way around. If we don't do enough for Ukraine, then we are endangering our security. Then we are depending on Russia, not only on Russia oil, but on Russia media, on Russian influence, whatever. As we always say, Russia will not stop at Ukraine, but it's not only about the Baltics, it's about the whole European Union. And that, of course, is very important to be much stronger, much more vocal on these issues and honest to our citizens.
Let me continue this thought by rewinding a little bit and saying, collectively as the EU, we have made a promise to Ukraine already. We have opened the door. It is quite likely that we're going to see the opening of accession negotiations in December. But have we sort of introduced the Trojan horse in our house when we did that? Because we weren't ready. Because it is likely that we're not going to have an easy time making good on our promises to Ukraine. What are the challenges that you are foreseeing, more on a political than an institutional level, or maybe the other way around?
Thank you very much for the question, and I apologize once again for the delay. In order to complement what the other panelists has already explained, I'll try to present a little bit more the institutional view of the EU as an institution. After the 24th of February, when the Russian aggression on Ukraine happened, we first introduced the biggest package of sanctions ever as the EU. At that time, there started a transformation of the European Union, something that has been unprecedented when you were still in the European Parliament. Immediately after that, EU adopted the Strategic Compass, a 10-year plan for building defensive capacities, something that has been not... that nobody could think, something that Javier Solana was dreaming when he was still in the EU. Started with that. We have launched the European Peace Facility. Until now, we have managed to grant 8.5 billion euros for ammunition and for equipment and lethal weapons through the European peace facilities. So far, altogether, the financial support to the Ukraine is amounted around 82 billion. Financially, we have kept our promise and we will continue. But even more so, even more than financial support, the two other things were important. One is that we have kept our promise as regards the European perspective for Ukraine. That has given hope to all the people who remained and stay there and who need to every day fight the aggression from Russia. First thing, and additionally, as the second thing, we have shown a lot of solidarity with the refugees that came from Ukraine. All this will continue. Additionally, what will continue, and internal political dynamics will not impact that, at least not in the short run, is our agreement on production of ammunition, especially caliber 155, which is necessary for the battleground, for the battlefield. It will continue our humanitarian support. It will continue also everything that we have done in order to make European Union more strategically autonomous and sovereign. It means all our policy not to be dependent of the Russian fossil fuels, our policy of building strategic economy to protect our supply chains, all these things which European Union needed to adopt in order to be safer against the war in Ukraine will continue and will make European Union different, but different meaning more resilient, better in reacting to events that are happening around us, and also faster in taking decisions. And when I speak about faster in making decisions, I'm also referring to internal discussion on qualified majority in the foreign affairs, and especially on the internal discussion that we are having on improvements of the enlargement. And this thing is now extremely important. There is another momentum of enlargement, and you can feel it. You can feel it among the heads of states and governments, and we feel it also within the institutions. We started to really honestly look into absorption, improving EU absorption capacities. In October, the heads of states and government at the European Council will discuss a review of the multi-annual financial framework, which is the EU budget, with the aim to provide enough money for the enlargement really to happen. To answer your question very quickly, what can we expect for Ukraine? European Union will give a very positive signal to Ukraine, because this is something that it's necessary geopolitically, geostrategically, and it is something that European Union is now getting ready for. Since we are in Belgrade, one more sentence. Our institutional aim and objective is, and this is something that High Representative gave me as the mandate, as an instruction, our strategic objective is that when the decision on Ukraine and Moldova will be taken, Western Balkans will also be in that package. And this is something that we are now very, very intensively working on. And I'll stop for the moment here.
Let me ask you something that I know you are probably not at freedom to speculate extensively on, but perhaps you can answer even within the limits of your mandate. Are there concerns about the follow-up? Because the start of accession negotiations is just the first step, and you have described a lot of the solidarity mechanisms, a lot of the ways in which the EU has made itself stronger. But how about the process with Ukraine? How can we have reform while we have a war? How can we enforce anti-corruption measures while we have a war ongoing? Do you feel this is going to be different from everything that we've done so far in terms of enlargement?
These are the internal discussions that we really have in this very moment. First of all, we will keep the merit-based approach to everybody, and same methodology for all 10 candidate countries or aspirants for the full membership in the EU. That's why the enlargement package, which will issue, which will be issued this year on the 8th of November, will include the country reports for all 10 countries. So on this basis, we will continue equally and the same. For Ukraine, we will need to introduce quite a lot of new instruments. Among them, first of all, the, some sort of a Ukrainian facility through which we will be able to finance, first of all, macro financial assistance and all other assistance, because we cannot use the pre-accession aid, which has been determined in the multi-annual financial framework, because if we would use that, we would basically immediately consume all the money for Turkey and for the Western Balkans. So a separate facility, that's the first thing. The second thing is adopted monitoring mechanisms for the implementation and for the track record of the reforms. Because as you said very properly, it's more difficult to monitor corruption when you have a country which is in war. It's obvious. We'll try to adopt that, and we are very much working on that. The third thing is the legal basis. If DF, Deep Comprehensive Free Trade Agreement, is enough, if we need to add any annexes in order to really allow Ukraine to follow their accession path, this is also what our legal experts are working in. And then we have clear efforts on the on the peace plan, where European Union will politically engage. And the fourth thing, which is many times not put in the first line, but it's extremely important. European Union is leading in impunity, in fight against impunity. So we are, together with our partners, working on the, some sort of a solution where we can actually have cases against the aggression in Ukraine. This is extremely also important to have some sort of a, first of all, to come to the end of the conflict, and also to have the reconciliation afterwards, when hopefully the war will end. May I just two more sentences? I apologize, very briefly. Which I forgot.
I will then have them challenge you on all of these things.
Yes,
so you're
please.
Free to add anything, but it's going to be ammunition.
No, we should not forget.
It's going to be used against you.
Just on your very excellent question on the connection of what's happening in Israel and the Middle East with Ukraine. Both conflicts have global dimensions or implications. This is something that is similar. Also, because both of them are happening on the terrain, on the field, and in the battle of narratives, which is, I should say, digital, or which is somewhere else. And in this battle of narratives, I'm not sure that the international community, those who are defending the democratic systems, are winning. Mm-hmm. Just these two sentences I wanted to add. Thank you.
Thank you. And let me just throw in two things. One is, ever since we've had this geopolitical momentum, we keep hearing that on a political level there's consensus, I think we can say, that this is a watershed moment, that this changes everything. But when it comes to the actual implementation, when it comes to who pays for Ukraine's EU accession or for Ukraine's reconstruction, or how far we're willing to go, what is the meaning of as long as it takes? That's when positions start diverging very much. And that is why we have the Franco-German report on the need of institutional changes within the EU to increase absorption capacity. But it hasn't necessarily been enthusiastically embraced all across the EU. So I'm wondering if you feel that that all the institutional steps that you've heard laid out are less likely to become reality because they're going to come up against the political reality of 2024 year-round elections everywhere. And from that derives my second question, which is still the bottom line is security. Ukraine wants security guarantees. It definitely wants to become an EU member, but it probably wants security guarantees above anything else. Is this something that the EU is likely to provide, or is the US still instrumental, and obviously the US internal dynamics instrumental, more than what happens in Europe?
All right. You're making the most relevant, the most obvious point, which is security. This EU integration process is going to be different than any other in several ways. The question is whether security is even a precondition of EU accession. Can we have an EU member that is not at peace with unsecured, contested borders, with revisionisms all around? And the answer to that has been given to us by one process that we know pretty well, which is the early process of the Marshall Plan in 1948, which did not come to pass until there were security guarantees, and they were codified in the Washington Treaty 1 year after passage of the European Reconstruction Act. And I think we're in a similar situation. So we shouldn't be focusing too much on the date of accession. I was in Kiev recently, and they're still talking about 2 years from now is when accession comes. But if you connect it with security, the question becomes, how do we define victory? Is accession and dual accession victory? And that is the question to be asked. The second question, and you mentioned it, Mr. Markowitz, this will be an accession process different from any other because it combines the conditionality of accession with reconstruction and reconstruction aid. And how to do that is currently being constructed by the EU Commission and the Ukrainians jointly, and therefore it's going to have to be different. So the combination of these things leads me to believe that we will not need European strategic autonomy, but we will need strategic integration. And that will then have to include the United States, because there will not be security without the United States. And I'm hard-pressed to believe, much as we've talked about the Vilnius summit, much as many of us who support Ukraine have been disappointed with the result, that the next summit will have a different result if 4 weeks later the Republican National Convention is going to take part place, and Joe Biden would have to defend in a campaign a security guarantee of that dimension on a battlefield that may not be decided at that time. So I would be careful about making prejudgments, other than to say that victory to me is double accession, and it comes in different steps in the reconstruction side and in the security side. And we should also remember there's two elements to this war. This war can be won or lost on the battlefield, but it also can be won by economic warfare. Mr. Putin's goal is to create a failed state. He can sort of linger on the battlefield, but win the economic battle. That is why it is so important what the European Union and, by the way, the United States, pretty good burden sharing between the United States and Europe on this question, are doing to support Ukraine with macrofinancial support, and for that to be ongoing, because we have a country right now that has a war and doesn't have hyperinflation. It has inflation, and it also has a debt to GDP ratio of 100%, which for a middle income country is reaching a danger zone. But we're nowhere close to what we would be seeing if it weren't for the support that the EU and the United States are providing. So I think the economics, the eventual reconstruction, security will go together, and the security piece and the accession piece will go together.
And before you answer, Can I ask you to perhaps also consider the fact that I feel there is an assumption that this relies on, which is that we're still going to have a strong transatlantic relationship. And just 2 weeks ago or less, before the Granada European Political Community Summit, I was part of the expert event organized just before that, all Europeans, obviously, and the question was asked, shouldn't we have a U.S. presence, a U.S. association of sorts to the European political community? And the almost unanimous answer around the table was no, because if the U.S. gets involved, that completely changes the perspective. So should we assume that we still have a strong enough transatlantic relationship that we can actually discuss these things in a cooperative paradigm?
I think we have to have a strong Atlantic relationship, Euro-Atlantic relationship, but I think at the same time our citizens expect Europe to grow as well. If we go only into an Euro-Atlantic relationship with all this institution, then people will ask, is Europe again only some subservient, some servant of the US? We should be very careful in doing that. On the other hand, of course, and the war in Israel shows very clearly, it is very important to have that relationship, shows it clearly in addition to what we see in Ukraine. So even maybe that the war in Israel with all the disasters has this effect that, again, it underlines the importance of the relationship with the US, but it should not be institutionalized so much outside NATO. Of course, with NATO, it's obvious. Now, coming back to the question was presented by colleague Markowitz, if I would have thought that you would react so strongly and efficiently with all my experience after 18 years in European Parliament, I would say no, it will not. It did, and that's great. Is it enough? No, it's not enough. Because what you do, and I'm very, very happy that you do it, the vision of Europe must be a different one. It's not only the accession, as you said quite rightly, it's a different kind of accession. I was rapporteur for Croatia. Croatia, a small country, had a, sorry to say it like that, a small war. And even then it was difficult. It's not, we cannot imagine what this war has an effect in Ukraine in the moment the war stops. What kind of divisions inside the country will, because there will be a strong division and antagonism about the question, was it right to have the war stopped now, or the negotiations, the compromise, the physical damage, the psychological damage to many people. How many people will return, will not return? And the people who had been outside, they will be called traitors because they left. So it's not just another country which is coming. It's a very different country, not because it's their mistake, it's the Russian aggressor, but it's a fact, besides other issues. So I think, of course, technically the two most important issues is the budget. You mentioned already that it's not possible to finance the enlargement, not only Ukraine, but the rest of it with the budget we have. But you know perfectly well how one minimum of percentage to change or to add has been rejected very often. This budget, the negotiations inside the EU, you cannot understand it from a political point of view. So the budget is one issue, and agriculture is another one. The country we have, you mentioned it, the country which was the staunchest supporters of Ukraine, when grain is coming from Ukraine into the country, that's now we have to block and even talk about not sending any weapons anymore. So we will have many of these disturbances in the course of the coming years. I don't say that we should avoid that and should not enlarge. No, I'm absolutely for. I was in the European Parliament years ago. I always said there is a sentence in the European Constitution, the Lisbon Treaty, any European country can apply for membership. It was rejected by the Council all the time. And I asked my fellow citizens also, part of Ukraine was part of Austrian-Hungarian Empire. Was it not Europe? So, but now we are a step forward. So absolutely for it. But please, I read recently an article by Carl Bildt, whom I like very much and did very much for the region here. But he said, well, let's go for Ukraine first, and then the Balkans will fall. I'm very grateful when you say have it in one package, because it would be very unfair to go only for Ukraine and not also for the region, and of course Moldova, and let's hope also for Georgia. Security, I think, is absolutely true. Security, hard security, military security, only in NATO can do it. There's a discussion, should it be NATO, should it be like security like in Israel? Not because of the events in Israel. I think the clearest answer would be NATO. Now, people will say there's a new border between Russia and NATO then, but we have it already. Not so long, but I think there is no other way around. The real security is only with NATO. Everything else will not be the real security from the military side. If the US is on board with it, we will see in the future. So I agree with you. Is this double package, and that must be said very clearly also to Ukrainians, this is the winning element of it. This is the victory, to have a stronger, quicker path towards membership in the EU and towards membership in NATO, even if it's not clear when. It's not the territorial question, difficult to say, but which is on top of it. The top must be that there is a security in the military sense, in the political sense, and in the economic sense, which is given to Ukraine, which would not have been given in any other way. And this is the victory of the support for Ukraine. And I think that has to be very clear. Otherwise, we will see a lot of disappointment in Ukraine, and not speak about many dates. States always disappointed the people because they never could be reached. They were always unrealistic on the enlargement issue. But the process is important. To start it now, to go forward, and to make it very clear, the victory for Ukraine is this double membership, and that gives them security. Them, but also our citizens.
But let me say that it's not just from the point of view of security, it's not just Ukraine that comes with its unique set of circumstances. It's Moldova as well, because they have a separatist entity on their territory, and Chisinau isn't actually controlling the entirety of the Moldovan territory. And based on our experience in the Serbia-Kosovo dialogue, we haven't been able, as the EU, to make tremendous progress in that process, which you would think should be peanuts as compared to the Ukraine-Moldova situation that we have. So on what grounds can we assume that we're going to be better prepared this time to deal with the realities, the security realities of Ukraine and Moldova, if we haven't really done such a wonderful job with Serbia and Kosovo?
Let me, maybe I'll try to go one step back in the past. We are still operating on the Thessaloniki agenda. In Thessaloniki in 2003, an agenda for enlargement has been set. All the mechanisms that we are using right now has been agreed at that time. And it has been projected for the enlargement in 2004. So all next enlargement had the methodology and very clear steps and steps. But there was one difference between the countries from 2004 and also Romania and Bulgaria and those who are now waiting to join the EU from the Western Balkans. And these are the remaining open issues. The one that are present here, and among them also Kosovo and Serbia question, are mainly deriving from the succession of ex-Yugoslavia, which brought to the conflict in the 90s, and that's why the societies were traumatized and had different ways and different approach to the reforms. It's something that the European Union is still learning, but it is learning effectively. We are learning we are preparing more and more internal instruments and ways how to deal and address the bilateral issues. And this is also one of the main points of the internal discussion that the member states and the institutions have on how to improve enlargement, to be able to address also the remaining open issues. It's necessary for the region of the Western Balkans, but also necessary for the for Moldova and Ukraine and Georgia, who also have European perspective. I will also mention Turkey, but Turkey does not have this kind of issues. So maybe I will not focus on them at the moment. The thing is, when we speak about the dialogue Belgrade-Pristina, we need to step back and try to understand what is this about. It's about an agreement which will change the character of Serbia and which will make Kosovo a state. Because so far, both of them are missing some elements to have one or the two. This is a big thing. It's a really huge thing, and that's why the negotiations are taking so much time. Recently, we had serious deterioration, which we will need to address. And one of the reasons why I was late was also because I had some meetings here in Belgrade to address what has happened on the 24th of September, and what are the dimensions and scales of that logistic operation and attacks, and what has brought to the point. Recently, what we see as a big challenge is that some scholars who have a deep understanding of the region started to compare a situation in the north of Kosovo with Northern Ireland, with West Bank. These are all very difficult conflicts. We don't want to compare it. We don't want to go there. Although I'm afraid that we are very close to a situation when we will be in these kind of settings. Still, the dialogue will continue and we'll try to prevent that. We will try to use all our efforts to bring both sides back to some sort of a political process and try to de-escalate.
What do you mean by all our efforts? I don't see these all our efforts, or they are not enough.
And isn't this a rather modest level of expectation? I mean, if the best we can do is just do our best, then again, what can Ukraine hope for from us?
No, that's a very solid question. We are operating within the mandate that has been given by the UN and that has been given by the EU. So the facilitator has his own limited mandate. He is trying his at most. We have to understand that we have managed to agree on a basic agreement from the 17th of February and in Ohrid the implementation annex, which is not being implemented. So the main effort right now is how to make or to use all our efforts to make the implementation. Now I will try to answer to your question, what are all our efforts? We tried with the measures on Kosovo. That's the one thing. We tried with different instruments that we have, financial and political. We will continue as long as necessary in order to bring both sides back to the table to agree on the implementation of the two, so the agreement and implementation annex. Maybe it's a little bit abstract, but this is where we are. We will use the member state support, so bilateral member state support, but also
institutions. I just don't want to turn this about Serbia and Kosovo because the topic of our panel is different.
The fact is that the nature of the conflict in Ukraine is different than the one in Kosovo. This one is more legal, institutional and constitutional, and that's why it takes much more time and we have less tools. We have only political tools, whereas the conflict in Ukraine will have a security dimension, and this is I will pass now the floor to
listening to this. I need to throw some salt in here. I think we're missing the point. If it is true, how I started out, that we've seen peak Ukraine, we need to think about how to redouble efforts, how to reverse that course. The conversation we're having here is assuming a linear progression towards accession. That is not what we see on the battlefield. Let's go and turn this around. It has, as much as I respect the European Union's effort in the last year, as much as I have seen, like I wouldn't have dreamt of, a role division between NATO and the European Union emerge, as much as I have seen more cooperation between these institutions, it is unclear to me whether the European Union or European countries are able to up the ante, to do what is necessary to be that needs to be done now. I don't see the European Union. I see the European Union staying the course, but I don't see it making a difference. When I was in Kiev, one of the things people told me was incrementalism doesn't win wars. So where is that thing that creates a new dynamic? Also, this is not on the EU per se as an institution. We also not, I don't think we're seeing the political leadership that actually embraces this issue anywhere in the major countries in Europe. I could talk about, as we say in EU lingo, about the could talk about the country that I know best. We're not seeing that political leadership. So actually, we should be asking different questions about how to break out of incrementalism, how to break out of linear thinking and continuity thinking, and how do we actually react to the current situation?
May I just add one sentence?
Sure.
I think, just in addition, could anybody in this room imagine that the European Union would more or less function like it is today with the 10 new members you spoke about? I don't think so. And that is not your mistake or the officials.
Of course not.
But that we all together, not only the politicians, all together have to think, what kind of Europe would it be, and could it be, and should it be? This is the basic question. And then from this point, we have to start then to think about how to proceed step by step to bring other countries into the Union and to change the Union at the same time, because this is the big issue. We have to bring countries into a moving target, because the moving target is the European Union, and we have to bring countries in. And that's very hard, but it's absolutely necessary.
Let me use your interventions that essentially say we have to ask the right questions to see if there are any questions emerging from the room. And let's open this up to the audience. So if you do have questions, please raise your hand so that you can get the mic. So we have questions over there, I think. We probably have mics around the room. Okay, let's collect a few questions.
Thank you, Oana. I hope it's on. Edward Joseph.
And please just very briefly introduce yourself.
Of course. Thank you, Oana. My name is Edward P. Joseph from Johns Hopkins University in Washington, D.C. And Oana, I thought you had that exactly right when you said, the Balkans, Serbia, Kosovo is peanuts compared to Ukraine. You hit the nail on the head. And I would just quickly, two questions here for Mr. Makovec. So, you referenced the events of September 24th, and here we are, we're here in Serbia. On that day, the High Representative, Mr. Borrell, issued a statement, a second statement, quite strong. He used the word terrorist, which obviously has rings in all of our ears today, and the word aggression, which has a particular meaning in international law in the UN. So my question for you, then, is given that, what about the issue of measures for something that High Representative Borrell himself, before any investigation, just based on the information we have now, and obviously the reaction in Belgrade since then, what about that question of measures? It would be good to be clear right here in Belgrade about that. And then secondly, what about the wider question you mentioned of the efforts of Miroslav Lajčak to bring the parties together, what we all would like to see, an agreement there. If, as he mentioned to me in Budva, as I asked Mr. Lajčak, if there is a take it or leave it deal presented to both sides, to Belgrade and Pristina.
Can I interrupt you for a second? And remind you, this is the Ukraine panel. So if this regards strictly Serbia and Kosovo, I think we're going to pass on that for the upcoming panels on the in the next days.
I'll just finish one end, and if Mr. Markovic wants to pass, but I only ask because you raised it, and I thought you raised it very well.
Yeah, but I raised it in the context of Ukraine. So is this in the context of Ukraine?
Totally. But we know Vladimir Putin wants this chaos, and we know Russia's interests here. So this is totally related to Ukraine. Absolutely. Related to Ukraine, we know Russia's interests here are to perpetuate instability. So this is totally connected to it. My question for you, Mr. Markovic, if Kosovo implements what everyone is after to stop Vladimir Putin's interests here in the region related to Ukraine, will Kosovo's application to join the European Union be approved, regardless of its recognition? If they implement the association, do as everyone asks, as the EU asks, will their application.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Let's pass the mic on to the back there.
Good afternoon. Tomasz Żurnaczuk from the Polish Institute of International Affairs in Warsaw. I have two questions. First, regards the offer to look for the answer whether a country without territorial integrity and control over the border has to be looked for in the past 8 years ago in the Marshall Plan, and also we had this comparison of Ukraine and Serbia, Kosovo. This discussion goes on or seems to go on as if there was no Cyprus joining in 2004. So my naive question is, why is that? And the second question to Mr. Markovic, if you could develop a little bit more on the second point of the new instruments in the EU integration of Ukraine, which was regarding the monitoring instrument. How different it is going to be from what we have now in the Balkans, that is primarily the progress report, and will it be valid only for Ukraine or also for the new negotiator or new candidate countries or new
Thank you,
countries
Thomas.
That start the negotiations, like Moldova or perhaps Bosnia as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's take maybe two or three more questions. I think somebody else already has the mic.
Okay. Thank you very much. My name is Alexandra Matas. I'm the director of International Security Dialogue Department at the Geneva Center for Security Policy. And my question will be about security and the role of United States, what Professor Svoboda mentioned in the European security. We discussed the importance of security guarantees for Ukraine and potential of Ukraine joining NATO. However, it seems that the American position is pretty clear that there will be no NATO membership for Ukraine at least until the hot phase of this war is ongoing to avoid a possible World War III. There, the importance of security guarantees or the so-called security arrangements that were discussed and the declaration of G7 after the Vilnius summit. We understand now that there are bilateral negotiations. My question is it if the United States gets caught in a way and its internal electoral processes and the questions of security arrangements for Ukraine goes to the back front, is there any European actor, a country, European Union, who can take a lead if United States is not there to provide those security arrangements for Ukraine? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's take two more questions, and I rely on the organizers to identify the people who want to ask them, because we have a lot of light in our eyes here.
Volodymyr Tolkach, Ambassador of Ukraine. First of all, thanks for organizers that you discussed today Ukraine. I just only would like to repeat the word of my president, not to talk about Ukraine without Ukraine. So in this case, I would like to say a few words, if it's possible. First of all, you see, I begin from the beginning. Today we see that the world conflict spread for the for other part of the world. And it's enemy not only for Ukraine. It's first what I would like to say, and we need to do something. I would like to also refresh your memory that the war in Ukraine began not only on 24th of February. It began in 2014, and we always ask for some support in those times. Maybe today it's difficult to say what it would be if your stronger opinion of other countries would be in those times when Russia occupied Crimea and part of east of Ukraine, so named Donbass. But today, thanks first of all for your support for Ukraine. But I would like to say to you that today we're speaking about support, but we are speaking about blood, about death of our citizen, day to day, only on the 5th of October, 56 Ukrainians died after this target of our little village in the east of Ukraine. In this case, I would like to turn your attention and ask you about that we need to do something and to strengthen the principles of our cooperation, or how we can to exist in this planet today, together. And in this case, my president proposed the formula of peace. This formula of peace is nothing, only the repeating of the principles of United Nations Charter. In this case, today we need to do something to produce some mechanism how to defend these principles. Principles of territorial integrity and all others, what we speak today. So in this case, my question, what is your opinion about how to strengthen this system of, because some days before we have Gaza, I don't want to speak about some problem in this northern region of Kosovo and so on, but
thank
we
you.
Are staying in this situation. Thank you.
Thank you. And I think we had
here.
Question somewhere over there.
Oana, I'm here.
Oh.
Isabel Leonidis.
We're going to take another.
The European Parliament's Research Service. I'll be very short. I understand the geopolitical importance of offering the possibility of accession to Ukraine, but have we thought about the backlash if we overpromise and underdeliver? Because after all, we are in the Balkans, and this is exactly what the EU has done in this region. So, you know, in a country where there's war, I think we'll arrive to EU fatigue much more quickly. And when I hear a time frame of 2 years, I panic. And I'm sorry to have to say this in front of the Ukrainian ambassador, but let's be realistic. What are we doing to prepare Ukraine for the clear possibility that this is a long-term process? Thank you.
Thank you. And let's take the last question there.
Sonia Stojanović-Gajić, a member of the board of BCSP. One more optimistic question, if we can say so. What are the lessons we learned from Ukrainians? How is it possible that they manage the state that is not falling apart, that they even keep some of democratic processes going on with the martial law in place in an operational war? And I'm asking this not just because of Ukrainians, but because of all of us. As we've said, many of the challenges Ukraine is facing and has been facing last couple of years are relevant for the rest of Europe. So what did you learn from Ukrainians and the previous investments in Ukraine that have delivered now, so that we can all build resiliences of our societies?
Thank you. We have a lot of questions and very little time, so I will allow you to pick and choose and ask you to be brief in your remarks.
I've only one question that is about the engagement of EU or US. We did not speak about the U.S. engagement in Asia and the Taiwan question. I think Taiwan would, raise the issue now as a new conflict. So I think it only can be shared. Neither U.S. alone nor Europe alone could do it. And there are many other questions. So I think this is the big issue we have to do. And only one other mention. I think next year it will be 70 years that the European Defense Agreement Pact between Germany and France has not been accepted in France. Would we have started then 70 years ago, we would be far away. We would be enormously effective. So the decisions have to be taken now and not stop our creativity to bring really defense into the mainstream of the European idea.
Thank you.
Also trying to be quick, I agree, can't be done with the United States. Without the United States, Europe can't replace that. The EU, the G7 security arrangements are a good transitionary instrument, but we have to make sure that it's not a final. That it's not a final instrument. A second piece, overpromise and underdeliver. I think it's being made sufficiently clear to the Ukrainians that their time frame is unrealistic. The shortest accession process was much longer. So I think that process is underway. Third element, territorial integrity. There's models that can be at least studied. My country, 1955, membership of NATO, is part of the country only, with an agreement that Article 5, with an agreement that that changes of borders would only be pursued in peaceful means, and if they weren't pursued in peaceful means, Article 5 would fall to the wayside. That's at least a model to think about, but it presupposes territorial changes. We're not in a position, and we shouldn't be talking about that, but it's what has been said several times, including by you, that there's different models, including in Transnistria, where we have territorial issues. All I want to say is there's models out there to be studied and emulated for such cases.
Very briefly, with a couple of sentences. First of all, European Union is learning how to move from linear functioning towards accelerated functioning. You have to understand, and Mr. Sloboda knows it much better than me, for decades European Union followed linear logic because we were preserving something that we have built together. And it was one of the most democratic systems and markets on the global earth. Now we need to learn how to better project stability in our vicinity. We had that as a word, as a political message, but now we need to learn how to do it effectively, quickly, with more robust institutions. This is something that is happening within the EU, especially because we want to address all the challenges that the new enlargement will bring. And I'm very much looking also to the ambassador of Ukraine. We are doing our utmost. We should start earlier, yes. We should do more, yes. But we are doing as much as we can. And we will continue doing as the EU. And this is also a very important point. There is a geopolitical discussion and understanding of the importance of the accession enlargement process and accession of Ukraine. And that's why some procedures will go faster. Therefore, the second mechanism will be a little bit adopted for in order not to raise too much expectations. But it will be adopted, but the main principles remain the same. The main principles, which are country reports, merit base, negotiations with the chapters, new methodology, this will all remain in place with understanding that we need to adopt it in order to be quicker, faster, and more efficient. And we should not forget one very important thing. Enlargement has been created in order to make European Union stronger. So therefore, we need to use this transformative power of enlargement more efficiently, and not introduce into the EU problems and weaken us as the EU. So this is something that we have very much in our mind, and that's why I'm also referring to some open issues that are also in this region. Why I believe that there will be faster address, why I believe that the EU will be able to faster address the problems in Ukraine, because we do understand the gravity of it. And the first thing and the second thing is also the global outreach of the war against Ukraine. We did not discuss about very important thing. What is happening right now is a clear attack on the multilateral world order that is being created after the Second World War. This is happening, and we are still thinking in that multilateral frame, but I believe we should also, all of us will need to start changing our frame. In the European Union, we have invested enormous, but really enormous efforts to gain support within the General Assembly for the resolutions on Ukraine. But the effect of resolutions in General Assembly has been weakened. We need to look for more, for different frames, for different forums, and for different mechanisms, because the world is changing in front of our eyes. And I absolutely will stop here.
Thank you so much. Ideally, the moderator would sum up the discussion, but I think that is impossible to do since it is so multifaceted and still very, very complex. And fortunately, we're out of time, so I have a very good excuse to just turn over to Valerie and Milan and thank everybody on the panel for their interventions and the audience for their very good questions.
So we discussed peak Ukraine, strategic integration instead of strategic autonomy, the risks of linear thinking, and of course also touched upon Kosovo-Serbia, which was unavoidable here. Thank you very much to the panelists who raised more questions than their answers for, and thank you to Dr. Popescu-Zamfir for such excellent moderation.
And I would just add two strong messages from this panel. The first one, support for Ukraine is not only about friendship, it's about the basic rights of the European citizens, and the message to Ukraine that the double accession, the double membership is the real victory in this situation. So this was the first panel of, and only panel for today, first panel of this year's Belgrade Security Conference, and we are going to proceed today's program with inaugural Lighthouse Award ceremony.
So please, Mr. Bandovic, back to you.
This is the last speech I have tonight. In an effort to prevent our historical role models from fading into obscurity and to draw inspiration from their actions, words, ethics and integrity, and honor of in the fields of security, foreign policy, international relations, diplomacy, the team of Belgrade Security Conference established a tradition last year to commemorate exceptional personalities from our history who have left a lasting legacy through their life's work and serve as a role models for our endeavors. The first honoree was Professor Vojin Dimitrijević, a professor of international law and the director of Belgrade Center for Human Rights. This year, we honor Milovan Milovanović, former Prime Minister of Serbia, politician, diplomat, lawyer, born in 1862 and passed away in 1912. With the intention of uncovering, reminding, and drawing attention to the true values of our society, individuals who serve as role models in our pursuit for a better and more just society free from fear, which is the vision of the Belgrade Center for Security Policy, we have also established the Lighthouse Award this year. The aim is to award individuals of exceptional courage in their professional tasks in the fields of security, foreign policy, both men and women. The Lighthouse serves as a reminder of the virtues that should characterize individuals in society, the direction in which society should progress, the qualities to be valued, nurtured, and rewarded. The Lighthouse is a symbol of the destination we should reach and the path we must traverse to become better individuals and a better society, with the courageous act of these individuals lighting our way. This year, Lighthouse Award will be bestowed upon Aleksandar Obradović. Aleksandar Obradović was born in Valjevo on March 2, 1979. He worked at the Krušik factory in Valjevo until he discovered corruption and fraud related to the arms trade within the factory. When he disclosed this information to journalists, he was arrested by members of the Secret Intelligence Service on September 18, 2019, and taken to prison in Belgrade on espionage charges. In October 2019, he was released from prison and placed under house arrest. News of Obradović's arrest led to mass protests in solidarity with him in Valjevo, Belgrade, and Novi Sad. In December 2019, public pressure and protests yielded results, and Aleksandar Obradović was released from house arrest. He is still under investigation today, and his whistleblower status has not been recognized. He has been suspended from his job at the factory. With his courage and professionalism, Aca Obradović prevented arrogant, corrupt elites from destroying a public enterprise through theft and corruption. Instead of being rewarded, he was subjected to persecution and tyranny of the autocratic regime marred in corruption. Aca Obradović describes himself as an ordinary man, but he's not just an ordinary man. In a society where there is no moral order, where the difference between good and evil is not recognized and not important, this noble act of Aleksandar Obradović is the unwavering struggle of a citizen against evil and a captured state that has taken control of all state institutions and poisoned nearly the entire society. Today, Aleksandar Obradović is a free man, and his path is the path of Lighthouse. Congratulations, Aca, with respect, your Belgrade Center for Security Policy.
I just want to say a big thank you for this award. I am deeply honored and forever grateful for this beautiful and important recognition. Thank you.
So this was it for today. You're all very welcome to join our welcome reception in Crystal Foyer. And please don't forget that tomorrow's program starts at 9 a.m. with the second panel of this year's Belgrade Security Conference.
Thank you very much. See you outside.